Amen. Stand you.
Thank you.
I'm take your Bible or open your app, all right? And I want you to, if you will, turn to, there's a couple texts. Let's just open to one, and I'll read the rest of them to you as we preach through the sermon. All right, here we go. So let's calm down and get to the point. John 16. I'm going to read just one verse to you. I'm really just going to really bring out one phrase. John 16, verse 7, Jesus is talking about the promise of the Holy Spirit. Today is Pentecost Sunday, and we're going to have a good time doing that. I want to very quickly, all right, one more thing. I want to thank Corey, all right, and all of the team, and Chad especially, Hafner, our media pastor. Most Sundays you come in here, this just doesn't happen, right? The sound is not amplified automatically. The visuals are not there. The light's not there. Those things happen. But most Sundays, there's a little bit of it already up and ready to go. This Sunday, because of other ministries that were going on here this weekend and the details and things that they wanted and give us to do, we had to make sure everything was cleared off, make sure everything was out of what we call our green room, all that good stuff. So this morning when they got here, they started from scratch, setting everything back up. And I just want to say as pastor, I don't know how you feel about it, I am grateful for their work. I am grateful for their work. Those watching by video and listening by podcast, it does not just happen. Chad Hafner and the team make sure that's taken care of. So I'm grateful. I promise you I'm going to preach about the Holy Spirit this morning, infused by the Holy Spirit. I promise you I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to explain to you kind of who we are. If you've not been with us from the very beginning, or you was with me when I was in a Southern Baptist church, I'm going to kind of give you some things this morning that will probably liberate you and explain to you who we are and what we do. But I got a lot of things on my heart. We were at a revival service. Really wasn't a revival service. It was a conference Friday night. Dr. Don Wilton. You ever heard of Dr. Don Wilton? He pastors a little bitty church in Spartanburg. Is in every state in the United States in 100-something countries. He's preached. He's a South African. He is just absolutely probably one of the best preachers of the Word of God that just absolutely dissects that Word. And it was a great service. But I was sitting there in this traditional Southern Baptist church, and in a church I love. I don't have a thing in the world I'm not criticizing. I'm sitting there, and it was one guy, middle-aged guy, playing the electronic drums, and one young man playing the guitar, a lady on the keyboard, is their worship pastor. She was leading them, and a young lady over here singing with them. And I will not tell you all the thoughts I had, okay? All right? I'm proud for what they're doing. I'm proud for what that pastor's trying to do in a traditional church. But I tell you, one of the main thoughts I had was this. Pastor Thad, you can tell, was not here today, all right? His family's away. And so Corey is leading another one of our pastors in town. I was thinking, I remember being at a place when we started 3 years ago. I won't even go back to the days I pastored traditional church. I remember when it was just Thad and his guitar. And we would pray every Sunday 3 years ago. We would pray every Sunday that neither one of us would get sick, because I do the preaching, he do the singing. And that is the deal we worked out a long time ago. And neither one of us try to mix with either of those things. We do, we usually get in trouble. And then along the way, God has brought Corey and Paige and Wesley and Bradley and Daniel and Nick, of course, wasn't here today. But just crazy amount of talent. And God began to speak to me and to be very thankful for what we have. So I just want you to know, and don't need your applause, I want you to know I appreciate you guys very much. It's never overlooked. It's never, ever overlooked. All right, now to the sermon. Here we go. Here is what Jesus is saying, and I want to pull out just about four or five words and kind of hone it. John 16, verse 7, say amen if you're there. If not, it should be on the screen because the media team is awesome. But in fact, it is best for you. I want you to, if you are cool with it and not like super spiritual, I want you to highlight or underline or save that part of it. I'm reading from New Living Translation, so it may sound just a little bit different than the New King James or King James. It is best for you. It is best for you. Okay, you got it. Because if I don't go, which is what he's talking about, the advocate won't come. If I do go away, then I will send him to you. And so I want to give you just really quick what he's talking about. Most of you know, you've been in church any amount of time. He He's talking about the Holy Spirit. He calls it the advocate here. It's New Living Translation. The word's been translated already for you, but it is advocate. He's talking about the pneuma. He's talking about, he's called many different things, but he's talking about the Holy Spirit. And then I begin to think about this. You with me? Say amen. You better buckle up, man. I'm ready to go. I began to think about this, and I told Sandra this yesterday when we finally settled down and I started going back over my notes. I began to think about, what do you want from God? I mean, think about it. What do you want from God? Now, there are probably a million things that you can fill in there. And don't be super spiritual and go, man, I don't ask God for nothing. Now, just about everybody asks God for something. Most of the time, it consumes our prayer life. It consumes all that we are. That God, this is what I want. God, this is what I need. God, I need help with this. And so I ask you again, what is it that you want from God? And you can put a million things in there. But then I begin to think about it in this realm. You still with me? Stay with me. I don't want just, listen to me. I don't want just the ordinary. I don't want just the average. I don't want to be an ordinary pastor. I don't want to be an ordinary husband. I don't want to be an ordinary dad. I don't want to be an ordinary son. You get that. And on this goes, I want to be more. As a matter of fact, I don't want to just be good. I want to be the best. Now, some of you say, well, that's arrogant. And that's, no. I want to be the best. And so if I say, what do you want from God? I don't want just the good from God. I want the best from God. The problem is most of us, me included, we settle for the good instead of the best. All the way back in the Old Testament, they get over, fix the crossover in the Promised Land. It looks like they would have learned their lesson, but they were still tribes and said, listen, just let us stay right here. This is good. And so they did. But they didn't go on in for the best. And so in that vein, let's look at it again. But in fact, and I have mine underlined. I don't know if you can see that way out there. But in fact, so he's saying fact. It is best for you. What is best for me? What is he talking about? He's talking about the Holy Spirit. He's not talking about things that you add to it. He's talking about the simplicity of him sending on Pentecost, what we celebrate today, the birth of the church, the empowerment from on high, the ability that is sent to us, the very best he has to offer is his Holy Spirit to us. So he says, everything that pertaineth to life and death, I'm giving to you in the Holy Spirit. And so I want to take us from just being average to trying to be the best in this community. Dr. Wilton said Friday night, and he's pastored for a lot longer than me, and preached to a lot more people than me, and knows a lot more than me. And you get the point, right? He said that he has, I don't know how many, because he's not trying to count them, people all in his congregation, everywhere he preaches, that are good. They love Jesus, they're saved, they're on their way to heaven, and they're good, but they're not making any difference. They're not making any difference. And so what I want to do, and I'm sitting there, in a traditional Baptist church Friday night, and they get a little wild. I'm not knocking what Pastor Tate's doing over there in the conference he's putting on. They got a little carried away. Like when you guys applaud after a song, I kept waiting for that the other night. I was like, it never happened. But during the preaching, they got some hands up. It's good. I mean, and it was, but I was wanting to say, listen, I get it. I understand. This is where I am. I need this. I don't want to just go through life. I want to make a difference. I want to be somebody that makes a difference in this world. It makes a difference in this community. It makes a difference for God and not for my name's sake. In order to do that, I need to be the very best I can for God, because it says to do everything as unto God and not unto man. And he says this, he goes back, there's that little phrase, it is best for you. What? He is. And so let me give you just a real quick outline. I'm going to read some more scripture in just a moment, but let me just introduce it first, okay, using this one verse. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. You listen to me, say amen. I want you to get this, and here's 3 points. Here's the first one. It's very simple. Some of you have been with me, and it's going to seem a little remedial. The Holy Spirit, first of all, is a person. The Holy Spirit is a person. Every time he is talked about, it is the pronoun he, him. It's not an it. It's a person. Now, why is it important that you get that it is a person? Because to have a personal relationship with someone, you have to see them as a person. You have to talk to him as a person. He is one of three in a triune Godhead. He is a person. The Bible, listen, and I've told you this last time I taught this. I think the series was called Ghost Stories, so you can go back and listen to all those. I'm not going to touch on everything that we talked about in that series. I told you this. It was not new to me. Pastor Robert Morris said this, and I grabbed it from him. He said, I would love, and if I didn't say that in the video and give him credit for it, I am now. He said, it would have been a whole lot easier, and I would love if God would have given him a name. If it, like, for instance, if he would have given him the name Bill instead of the Holy Spirit, if he had just said Bill, and if you remember, I taught you, and I'm going to teach you again this morning, the reason it is hard for us to see him as a person is because we don't really have that name like Bill. And that would have been cool because the First Baptist churches or the Uptown churches, well, they could have called him William. And then us, kind of wild and a little crazy and on the edge, well, we could just say Billy. It would have been a whole lot easier if God would have given him just a personal name like that, like Jesus, in Jesus' name. And so it is difficult for us to grasp the concept that the best thing for us is to understand that he is a person and he has a personality and he wants to have a personal relationship with you. And why is it so important? Well, because it is hard for me to say, Sandra, I want you to help me have a relationship with your coworker, Miss So-and-so. I can't have a personal relationship with someone she works with through her. If I want a personal, don't look at me like, duh. It's just this simple preaching. It's just what he's talking about. To have a personal relationship, you've got to speak to someone. You've got to engage that person. You've got to learn from that person. You've got to walk with that person. You've got to sometimes cry with that. You understand what I'm saying? And so for you to understand what Pentecost is about and what the Holy Spirit is about is to first realize he's a person. And he has all the attributes of God, all the omnis. As a matter of fact, I can prove to you, and I will not take the time this morning because this is just introduction. I know he's the person because the Bible teaches us, not only does it use those words, but it teaches us that, well, he has emotions. In Ephesians, it talks about, and if you remember in the series, back whenever I preached it, I can't remember, I really give you all the verses to back this stuff up. He has emotions. How do we know that? Because it says that you can grieve the Holy Spirit. We know that he speaks. We know that he speaks because it says even at times we don't even want to pray and the words to use, God, through the Holy Spirit, prays for us. So we know he speaks and he speaks to us and he speaks to the Father. We know he has emotions because it says we can grieve him. We grieve him by sinning and not doing and embracing all that he wants to do through our lives. So we know that he's a person. And so to begin a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit is to first recognize him as a person. Now, a relationship with him will make all the difference in your life. You listen to me? Most of us, and here's where this one Sunday message, because it's Pentecost Sunday, we don't normally just celebrate it. We're going to start a new series next week called God Never Said That. And we're going to deal with things like, I see it all the time. I know God said he had never put more on me than I can handle. No, he didn't. He never said that. And I'll prove it to you in a couple weeks. Back to this one. It's Pentecost Sunday. It's personal. It's power. And the reason it's so important that you get it this morning, and I hate that there's several that are missing it this morning due to all kinds of things that are going on. And hopefully they'll listen to this. It's because the reason, and when I said you want to make a difference, most of you said amen, but the reason you're not making a difference is because you're not doing it through the power of the Holy Spirit. You're trying to do it on your own. And let me tell you something, all the way back in the Old Testament, there's two guys tried to take fire in on their own. The Bible calls it a strange fire. Man, it didn't work because it wasn't the fire of God. And most of us, we try to build our own fire. We try to do it our way. And the reason it's important you'd have a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit and embrace this, it's not about a denomination. It's not about being weird. Because you're already weird. It's not about being weird. It'll absolutely absolutely revolutionize, completely change, 180 your walk with the Lord. I'm not saying you're not saved, not saying you're not good. I promise you it'll change you. Will you go to the, if you want to, you can turn there. They'll be on the screen. Acts chapter 2, 1 through 4, 14 and through 17. They'll be on the screen if they're there. I want to show you. I'm going to give you one example. I'm going to give you one example. I'm going to use Peter, all right, of how important it is to have a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. I'm going fast because I'm going somewhere with this. And how it absolutely changed your life. We're just going to look at his life on the day of Pentecost, and we're going to go from there. Is that okay with you? I'm glad it is. Here we go. Acts 2, verse 1. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Verse 2, suddenly there was a sound from heaven like a roaring mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames of tongue of fire, and remember, it says it looks like, all right? It doesn't mean that's what it was. It looks like flame or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each one of them. Verse 4, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages. Glossary, we get that word in the Greek is where we get our English word glossary. They just translated the word language. It was the verbiage that was being used. It's different between speaking in tongues, the gift of speaking in tongues and gift of interpretation, and our prayer language, speaking in tongues. It's different. It's a different speaking in tongues here, okay? All right? And you say, what in the world? I don't have time to break all that down. Go back and get the podcast or give me enough outcry and I'll teach it next week, all right? Here we go. And all of them spoke, and the Holy Spirit gave them ability. Verse 14, let's look at Peter's life. This is how it changes our lives, okay? Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem. Make no mistake about this. These people, because they've been accused of being drunk, these people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. There's someone somewhere going, no, it's not. It's 9 o'clock somewhere. Sorry, just had to. Verse 16, let's make sure you're listening. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet. What a wonderful name, Joel. In the last days, what Joel said, listen to me, I'm being funny, but I want to make sure I keep you engaged because there seems to be a mighty war going on this morning. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people, your sons and your daughters. Be very careful, you legalistic person that says that your daughter can't speak or preach for Jesus, because Joel took care of that in the Old Testament. Women have just as loud a voice as a man. Is that okay? Is that all right? That's okay. But it's all right with me, and it sure was all right with God. Your sons and your daughters, because sometimes my daughters throw my sermons back at me. I'm just being honest with you. And my wife, more than they, will prophesy, teach, lead, speak forth for God. Your young men will see vision, and your old men will dream dreams. I want to say right there, I'm still seeing visions because I'm still young. Now, stay with me. Stay with me. Yeah, 4-0. Where did the time go? Holy Spirit is a person. Personal relationship. Why is it important? Why is it important for you and for me to embrace him as a person? First and foremost, it is to have a relationship with him. It'll be weird, and you'll have to discipline yourself to say Holy Spirit. Because I don't think you want to say parakletos, which is a Greek word there. Para, I took my grandmother to the, can't remember what the technical thing, but for the thyroid, from some thyroid specialist, endocrine. Anyway, whatever. Come to find out, when the doctor comes in over in Green, really nice guy too, really soft-spoken guy. Because I told her, I said, what am I doing sitting in this room? I'm not here for me. Why am I nervous? He come in and he goes, it's actually not your thyroid. It's your parathyroid. I knew exactly what he was going to say when he said para. It's the one beside. There's four little, like, BBs that sit on each side, two on each side of your thyroid. Anyway, it's para. So parakletos, the Holy Spirit, is someone that comes alongside. I know that you probably won't say, okay, parakletos, or one that comes alongside. I know that you probably won't say counselor. I know you probably won't say convictor. But you got to get in the habit of saying Holy Spirit. If you want to go old school, Holy Ghost. It's to have a personal relationship, because it will absolutely change your walk with Jesus. We see it in Peter's life. Let me give you two other points about the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to show you them in this moment, in Acts chapter 2, in this setting. First of all, the second of the three is the Holy Spirit is Pentecostal. The Holy Spirit is Pentecostal. We see this very evident in this text, in this setting right now. And I want you to understand, you listen to me, say amen. I'm not talking about the cultural definition, Pentecostal. I'm not talking about the historical definition of Pentecostal. I'm not even talking about the denominational definition of Pentecostal, which you may think means that I'm saying now we don't want our women to wear makeup, for all of them to put their hair in a bun, which is bondage. I'm not talking about that at all. I thank God for makeup for you ladies. I do, all right? Some of you men probably could learn a few things, but I'm just saying it's not what he's talking about. And when we say that he's Pentecostal, we're talking about Pentecost Sunday. What is this all about? Well, here's what we're going to try to define and kind of put some parameters around who we are based on the scripture, and make sure that you want to be linked with one community church and this crazy preacher, all right, and this team. And so the Holy Spirit is Pentecostal. I mean, John was a Baptist, so the Holy Spirit's got to be Pentecostal, right? John the Baptist, the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. We get it, right? Right? We're not talking about those things. What we are talking about is the complete work of the person of the Holy Spirit. The fruits and gifts of the Holy Spirit is for us now. Total and absolute need to do everything relies on our walk and embracing a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. We'll break the word down. We're talking about Pentecost here. You with me? I know I'm plowing a little weird here. I want you to stay with me, all right? Pentecost, literally. Everybody would have been in town. We know because the Bible teaches us there was 120 in the upper room. I'm just going to freestyle. I don't need away from those notes. It's 120 in the upper room. Jesus already promised, John 14, he starts talking about going away, John 16, John 17, he talks about the Holy Spirit, he talks about the counselor, the convictor, he would convict those of sin, he would convict those of right. Have you ever been convicted of being righteous? He reminds you that you are his. You don't hear that preached about a lot. So they're waiting, they're praying, and he tells them in Acts 1, he says, tarry until the Holy Spirit, to the promised one, because Jesus was here 40 days, all right? He tells them to wait, and so they're in their upper room, about 120 of them, and then we know, because I've read it now, that like a mighty rushing wind, this big windstorm blows through there, the power, it was so powerful and so loud that all the community, or that's why they come, and said, man, and then they heard them talking in all the different languages of all the people that were there, and they go, they're drunk. They're crazy. And why there were so many people there is this is the time of year that they would come together, and there were seven feasts in the Jewish people. God, is it okay if we just go away from script? There's seven feasts. Inside those seven, there's seven altogether. There's three major feasts. All right? There's three major feasts. And inside those three major feasts are the other feasts that are there, okay? I know it's weird. Read your Old Testament. It's actually cool if you begin to study and then look over the New Testament and see how they're fulfilled. All right? The first festival that they celebrate together, the Jewish people celebrate together, was the Feast of what? You smart bunch of people. You just want to see if I know, right? It's the Feast of Passover. It's the Feast of Passover. It is literally, it marks what? Don't get real deep. It marks Passover. Duh. It is the night. It is the night the death angel passed over all the homes and did not take the firstborn in those homes, or the children in those homes, when they saw the blood that was outside the doorpost. You remember that, right? And so they would come together and they would celebrate and praise God, have a festival over that, the Feast of Passover. And then, watch this, you listen to me, it's going to get crazy, right? Pentecost Sunday, why are we celebrating today? Why is it so important for us? Then they would celebrate the Feast of Pentecost. The word is penta and costi. Penta being five sides, often referred to and associated with grace. Costi being to the tenth power. So we get our word Pentecost or Pentecostal. Pentecost being 50. All right? Now you listen to me. Second of major feasts, all right? I know I'm plowing a little bit deep. I know, but stay with me. I promise you it'll be good before I let you go. Help me, Jesus. Jesus was with us 40 days. After he was crucified. You with me? When he ascended to the right hand of the Father, he told them to stay in that room and pray. They pray for 10 days. Make 50 days. 50. Pentecost. 50. 5. Costi. 10th power. Add this one. Pentecost. All right? And so On that 10th day, the Holy Spirit fell. He sent that he promised. He sent what he had promised, and it changed their lives. And so when you say, is the Holy Spirit Pentecostal, we say he's absolutely Pentecostal, because we know what it truly means. It's not denominational. It is that they were celebrating the Feast of Passover. Watch this. And then they were celebrating the Feast of Pentecost. Now, here's what's crazy, right? Here's what's crazy. Go back with me, not literally turn there, but I want to take you there. Go back with me to when all of this, why did they celebrate? Because you think, well, there hadn't been Pentecost yet. No, no, they already had the festival or the Feast of Pentecost. Why? Because you go all the way back, all right, into Exodus, when they passed, the death angel passed over, all right? This is so cool. Because some of you, you probably haven't seen this before. This is really, really cool. And if you have, just act like it's just an awesome thing right here. In the Old Testament, stay with me, please. In the Old Testament, after the Passover, I promise you, do the math, 50 days later, Moses goes on Mount Sinai to get what? The first set, because he breaks the first set, but he goes up to get the Ten Commandments. Okay? So they're already celebrating that here's what happened. The Passover, the blood, the grace, the mercy, and then 50 days later, God's going to send the law. God's going to send the law. Moses goes up. Now watch this. This is phenomenal, okay? Phenomenal. You fast forward all the way to what I just read in Acts chapter 2. Here's the fulfillment, because Passover's already been fulfilled. Jesus Christ bore the cross, died on Calvary's cross, 3 days later, come back to life, once and for all, sacrifice, all right? The blood of the Lamb, slain for the remission of all sin, okay, fulfilled in a moment. And in this moment, Pentecost would be fulfilled. Where, watch this, where in Exodus 32, you remember the story? Moses goes up on the mountain to receive the law. While he's up on the mountain receiving the law, he starts his way back down to the camp, and what does he hear? He hears a party. That is the best way to describe it. They thought, well, he's not coming back. Go back and read your Bible. It's cool, man, if you'll really read it. He's not coming back. And so they took all the jewelry in the camp, melted it down, and made a what out of it? An idol, made a cow. And they began to just get naked and dance around that booger, worship the best they knew how. They began to just go back to who they were and knew from all the pagans around them. So they began to worship that. And I want you to listen to me. I want you to listen to me. And in that moment, as he comes down, he begins to plead with God because he knows what is going on. He's got word of what's going on. And I want you to get this. At Pentecost, in that moment, in the Old Testament, God tells them to tell the Levites, the priests, to go and to do what? Kill 3,000, Exodus 32 tells us. Why is the Holy Spirit so important? Why is it? I'm getting there, but before I get there, I want you to get some truths about this. And so I want you to understand this, okay? He tells them, and so they killed 3,000, all right? Let me tell you another story in the Old Testament, talking about Pentecost. Do you remember? I promise you, I'll tie it all together. I've done it before, but I want you to listen to me. Do you remember, I think it is in Genesis 11, there was this group of people that come together, and they started to build this tower, and it was called the Tower of what? Babel. Why was they building that tower? They wanted to get to heaven. They wanted to get to God. And on their way up, in their prideful attempt to get to God, because they were smart and they were one accord. Now listen, I promise you I'm teaching you something about how the Holy Spirit is Pentecostal and why it's so important, Pentecost Sunday. And on their way up, God, he does this. He says, he curses them. And when God says, I love what Dr. Wilt, because most people think when you hear curse, you think of foul language, but that's not what God, when God said he curses, it stops his blessing. He puts a stop on it. And so he stopped them. And watch what, I'm telling you, the scripture is very clear. He changes all their language. They're confused and they scatter. Pentecost, The fire and the cloud comes down to Moses, which is a typology of the Holy Spirit. He gets the Ten Commandments, and yet they sin in that moment, and 3,000 are slain in that moment, and he starts over. And then we have the Tower of Babel that's happened before that. They try to get to God, and he makes them where they speak all these different languages and all this. And watch this. Here's where we tie all this together. And on this Pentecost Sunday, no one had to try to get up to God. No one had to be prideful. There were 120 in the upper room that were humbled, and they were begging God and waiting God for his promise. And in that moment, I want you to listen to me. Is he Pentecostal? Yes. And in that moment, on that 50th day, the Holy Spirit came down and through them. And watch this. He unified them. They went from all these different languages to one language. And watch this. He didn't kill 3,000. It literally says, after Peter preaches, 3,000 lives were saved that day. And so it's important that you understand and embrace the Pentecostal Holy Spirit. It's as if he reversed the curse, as one preacher said. He brought them back together, and instead of taking life, he gave life. And so you say, is the Holy Spirit Pentecostal? We'd say, yes. It's kind of like us. You with me? Say amen. We at one baptize by immersion. We believe the Bible to teach immersion. Let me explain. That you go completely into water and you come completely back up out of the water. Jesus didn't go halfway in the tomb and then come back out of the tomb. He went completely to death and come completely back to life. And so as a symbolic representation of how your life goes from death to life, we put you into water and bring you up. What other denomination does that? Baptist. But we're not Baptists. We at one believe in water baptism. We at one also believe in the Holy Ghost baptism. We believe that at the moment of salvation, the Holy Spirit absolutely comes to reside in your life. But to be totally immersed into the Holy Spirit is not being baptized by the Holy Spirit, but being baptized into the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gets all of you. May he change your language? He might change your language. That is not in this sermon. I do believe he gives you a prayer language. That is how we believe here. But are we Pentecostal? No. We actually are non-denominational. And when we did that, I didn't realize that that was a group in themselves. I'm glad we got Heath around because they said we're snake handlers. And I'm like, well, I guess we are, really. At least one of us. Just kidding, watching my video. So I ain't never coming to that church. Do you understand when we say that he's Pentecostal, it's more than this label. It's more than this denominational definition or this cultural definition. It's more than what you've been taught. And when I started over, listen, my journey's crazy, man. Y'all know it most. I share it as often as possible. It's part of my DNA. I grew up at Lydia. I'm a Newry boy, all right? I'm a mud cat from way back, all right? That's just how I roll. I don't know why Sandra brought this up the other night, but she's like, where you want to be buried? The conversation was deeper than that, no pun intended. Gosh, I'm good. I have no idea, just all of a sudden. Do you want to be buried? True story, right? Yes. I told her real quick. I think the thing she was getting at, I don't want to be buried with her. You know, I said, I'm going to be buried with my mama. I'm being serious, I can be. There's a little cemetery. It's a little grave place where the shell goes. It's right across from Corinth Baptist and Seneca. It's called the Courtney. I want to be buried with my other Nereites because you either had to work at the mill or be from Nere to be in there. And I didn't work at the mill because it was shut down way before my time, but I'm from Nere. So I say all that to be a little funny and tell you she knows that's where I want to be buried. And I'd love if she's buried beside me. Unless you go before me and I get a sugar mama, I don't know, but I'm just saying, okay? Just kidding. Watch my video. I'm just kidding. Y'all are wrong, man. This is Holy Spirit we're talking about here. Stay with me. Listen, you say, why'd you tell us all that? I don't know. I just told you to be stupid, I guess, and be funny. But I was getting at this. I started out as a kid, like a Timothy. I told you I was going to weave us in here this morning. And so what little bit of church I went to, at the Baptist church on the Near Mill Village, my mom and my grandmother made sure that I was there. Joshua knows it was there. And his sisters and a lot of us, he's younger than us, but we grew up going to, Ralph kept us busy with youth stuff, and we'd play wiffle ball on a asphalt parking lot. And I don't know if we were playing football beside the church or we was really just fighting over there. I don't know. It seemed like a little bit of both, I reckon. But I started in Baptist church. Turned around 18, I guess, 17, 18. Got in trouble at school, quit school. Parents tried to, they did the best they could. Started dating this person. They're going to an Assembly of God. I go to the United Assembly of God. I've shared that before. I start going to United Assembly of God. I'm going somewhere with this, I promise you. So it's more than a denominational thing. I start going there, and I realize I didn't know church could be like this. I had no clue that it could be, and I mean this with absolutely no disrespect or no pun or anything in it. I didn't know it could be a party like this. I did not know that you could celebrate. Not saying that Lydia was bad. I just was a kid. I didn't understand, man. And then God, one Sunday morning, gets a hold of me in this Assembly of God and understand the speaking in the tongues and the dancing and the prophecy and all these things. I get all that, but I didn't really understand it. And all of a sudden, God takes me back to a Baptist church. I go off to Baptist seminary. Fast forward, I quit the ministry a few years ago. I started looking for somewhere to get plugged in. God takes me back to a church of God because it was alive. And man, I'm talking about God was speaking. And so you say, well, are you Baptist or are you Pentecostal or Church of God? And are you? I'm just a Christian, man. I'm being real with you. I'm trying to be funny. I don't want you to think that we're talking about any kind of hokey pokey or that you've got to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, or if you don't speak in tongues and you not have evidence of the baptism. Man, I'm not talking about all that silliness and nonsense and all those stereotypes. And I would never force that on you. Matter of fact, we have people in this audience now. And the hundreds, but over 1,000 has come through here in nearly the 4 years as we chart our numbers. In fact, I can't tell you how many people write me and say, man, I want that relationship with the Holy Spirit. You say, well, what makes you hungry for that? What is it about? It is about, here's the last thought as we give invitation. It's about the power that is infused. What Pentecost Sunday is about, what will revolutionize the church as we know it, what will revolutionize the community as we know it, is the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through our lives. That's the baptism. That's what it's about. Not about a language. It's not about the silliness and the herky-jerkies and all this good stuff. It's not about those. Not about the show. It's not about those things. Those guys were huddled up in that room. They went out bragging nowhere. They were absolutely on their face before God. And bam! And I showed you one instance here. The power failed. Power fell on him. Listen to me. Here's the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of the Holy Spirit, first of all, is the power unto salvation. It is the Holy Spirit that will convict you. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You take the Word of God preached under the power of the Holy Ghost, and that is not me. I cannot tell you how many people down through the nearly 20 years that have said, how in the world did you know my story? Or walk into the church building and go, I had no idea. Nobody emailed me. Nobody called me. Nobody. And listen, I've had them down through the years try to tell me. I'm not even going to listen to them. That's the power of the Holy Spirit bringing conviction in your life and will convert you. It's not only the power to save, but it is the power to stand up. You're listening to me? You say, now, where is that in the Scripture? The Bible says that Peter stands up and loudly. You see, what you need is to stop trying to stand up on your own and embrace the power of the Holy Ghost and say, God, in your power, in your strength, I will stand up. And watch what happens. This great courage falls over Peter, who just a few days earlier would be denying Jesus and running from Jesus. And in that moment, baptized in the Holy Ghost, He has the courage to stand up. Not only does he have the courage to stand up, but his courage was contagious, because in Acts chapter 2, as I read to you, not only did he stand up, but the 11 others stood up with him. Did you know if you'd stand up, your wife would stand up beside you, sir? Did you know if you'd stand up, your kids would stand up? Did you know if you'd stand up as a group of 100 plus people at one community church, that this community would stand up with you? That's the power of the Holy Ghost. That's Pentecost. It's the power unto salvation. It is the power unto service, which is to stand up. And then he will cause you to speak out. You have a voice. Matter of fact, look to your neighbor and say, you have a voice. Come on. Now look to your other neighbor and say, you have a voice. Now tell them they need a breath mint. You have a voice. You have a voice. You have a story to tell. You have a voice. And I know my camera people are real happy right now. Those watching later in the week will be like, I'm glad he's wide open right now. Shum, shum, shum. You have a voice. You have a story to tell. You see, what the problem is most of you are trying to tell your story in your own power. You're using your voice to be critical and to criticize when you should be contagious and courageous, letting the Lord speak through you, even if it's to change your language. Amen. That's Pentecost. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why it's so important to see Him as a person and embrace a personal relationship, because you have a voice. You have a voice. You have something to say, and the world needs to hear it. No longer do I need you to sit in the back of the church or on the sideline. I need you to stand up and to speak out all the things God has done for you and is doing in you right now. You have a voice. And what's crazy is this. Is it changed everyone around me? Because here's what the people said. Acts 2, 37, 39. Peter's word pierced their hearts. And they said to him, and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Peter replied, each of you must repent of your sin, turn to God, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive, I don't have time to preach it this morning, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise to you, listen to me, I'm done, all right? I'm done. This promise is to you, to your children, to those far away, all who have been called by the Lord Jesus. Some would say Pentecost happened one time and it was done. The gifts of the Spirit is a dead gift. He said, this is a promise to you, to your children, and to this crazy, goofy, weird bunch of multicultural people sitting in a high school auditorium. Pentecost Sunday 2016. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is alive. The Holy Spirit is real. He will absolutely revolutionize your life. He will change you. He will change you. He will change you. He will change you. And He will change the people around you if you let Him work through you. Would you stand to your feet, please? I want you to listen to me. I got up this morning and I was getting up super early. Make sure I just understand. I don't know what it's been the last few months, man. It's just this craziness. So I get up early to try to seek the Lord. I get my iPad out. I get my notes out. I want to make sure I'm on track. Listen to me. I promise you. You have a voice. I don't want you to ever doubt that God is using you. I open my iPad and I see in my messenger. But I don't really check it all the time, but I see there's several red little dots there. So I might need to look at it. And there was one this morning in there that has literally made my day. The former student of mine, I'm gonna say his name, he's a former student of mine at a church I pastored several years ago. He's grown now, he's a young man. He inboxed me. I want you to listen to what he said. He said, I've been listening to all your podcasts. He said, I'd love to come to church with you. Where you guys meet? Told him, he said, well, it's been a couple weeks I work on Sundays, my work schedule's crazy. He's a student. Probably 10 years ago, probably more than that. I had lost complete touch with him. Just opened up in social media, just opened up. He said, I've been listening to all those podcasts. So those of you that do work in media and sound, audio, God is using. I'm telling you, you have a voice. And if you can use someone like me, I promise you, if you embrace the power of the Holy Spirit, first of all, to save you and to change your life. But if you'll say every day, God, this is your day. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Use me. May I be your spokeswoman. May I be your spokesman today. May I absolutely go and do where and what you'd have me to do. Even if it's on my same job, in my same home, in my same school, God, use me today. I promise you have a voice and you have a story to tell. And it is a story unlike anyone else. But as the song would go, as you begin to tell your story, you will always tell his story. And people will want to know, how can I have that? Every head bowed, every eye closed in this place. He said, you first must repent and believe. So if you're in this place this morning and you need to be saved and set free, his mercy and his grace is as fresh and new as it was all those years ago. All you have to do is say, Jesus, for there's no other name. Jesus, save me. I turn from the way I've been living, the things I've been doing, the mess I've made of it. And I give it all to you right now by faith. I embrace your way for my life.